When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir?
Yeah.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeppy. Let's start the show.
You know, the Sasquatch Chronicles has really grown into something bigger than I ever imagined. If you would have told me a year ago we'd have just under 500,000 people listening to us and we'd be on 3 different radio stations in 3 different states, I would have told you you're crazy. I truly feel like the show's gotten to the point. It's the best that we can do at this point as far as creating the show. And so we've come to this dilemma, and I wanted to share it with you, the listener. We've come to this dilemma: do we keep doing the show the way we're doing, or do we take it to the next level? And a lot of people maybe don't realize that we all work full-time jobs, and so it's hard to put more and more into the show. I would love to make the show bigger. I'd love to add more content. And so we came to this dilemma on, do we quit doing the show? You know, do we say we had a great run? Thank you to everyone who listened. Thank you to everyone who supported us. Or do we take the show to the next level? And what we decided to do was monetize the podcast. And so I wanted to give you, the listener, an update on what's going on, because it is your show as much as it is our show. And so what we're thinking about doing is charging a couple dollars a month, and we're in the process of building a website. I'd like to move the show to a 2-hour format a week, maybe even do 2 shows a week, add video content, really put as much as we can into the show for you guys. So some changes are coming down the road, but I wanted to let you guys know on what is coming. Tonight on the show, we talked to Larry Turner. Larry is an investigator. He had an encounter back when he was younger. He's now an investigator. He's going to share with us tonight some of his audio and his encounter stories. And then we'll close out with the news with Shannon LeGros.
Let's start off with, I always ask people, you know, what they knew about the subject prior to their first encounter.
I heard about Bigfoot or Sasquatch when I was a boy, about, say, when I was in the early 1960s. So I was always aware of them, but I always thought they were in Canada. You know, that was when I was a kid, you know. And then when I became an adult, I was fully aware that they're everywhere, so... But as a kid growing up, I thought, oh, they're just in Canada.
So what, tell us about on that first experience, what were you doing that led up to the event that happened?
Oh, my very first experience 37 years ago?
Right.
I was elk hunting, and it was down at the bottom of a canyon chasing a six-point bull elk, and I lost him in an alder thicket. So looking around for him, couldn't find him, figured out, well, I'm 4 miles down, I might have better come out. So a couple hours into it, coming back up the hill, I found a skid road, and I started walking up the skid road rather than beating the brush. And there was a thick brush about 20 yards to my left, which would be south of my position as I was heading up the hill. All of a sudden, I just stopped, and I was like, something's wrong. And I was like, this doesn't feel very good. And I've been around bear and cougar my entire growing up, and they don't bother me. So what is wrong? And I just had this hair standing on the back of my neck. I couldn't tell you what was wrong. I jacked a round into my cambered one in my rifle, and I started walking up the hill, and I crossed up on my left periphery vision, and I see this black mass, huge black mass going through the brush, and it was, I'd take a step, it would take a step, and I kept on looking at it and going, is that a bear? What? He'd be gone by now. So about 100 yards, well, this thing's walking up there, it's doing this, all the way, and of course, I was really nervous then because I'd never seen a bear do that, and I'd see bits and pieces of an arm and a long leg. And, you know, I was double-timing it up to the truck, and it was doing that sound and following me in the brush all the way up until I got the mainline road. When I got the mainline road, I did a 100-yard dash like you wouldn't believe and got out of there.
Did you ever go back?
I didn't know.
To see
what? Nah, it was like I had no idea what that was all about. Matter of fact, I haven't been down that way since. It's because they bermed off the road where you can't drive over there anymore. It's long. If I were to walk there, it'd take a day and a half to get there. It's in the Coast Range in Oregon.
Okay. So after that incident, did you tell anybody?
Not a soul. Not a soul up until last summer. I didn't even tell my wife.
That's very typical of these situations. I've interviewed thousands of people over the years and many, many times. You know, so
how do you explain
company.
It?
You're in good company.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly. You know, especially that's the thing most people don't understand. You know, when you have an experience like that, how do you tell it to somebody who hasn't? There's just no way to relate that to somebody who hasn't had the same experience. What led you to get involved in actually doing research on the subject?
All right. Well, about 2 years ago, this last month, my daughters were out camping in the Coast Range. They're adult daughters. And I pretty much have had them outdoors the whole life. I've taken them backcountry, Yellowstone, the whole nine yards, Montana, up a glacier for 3 weeks. So they're experienced outdoor girls. There are seven other people with them, all, you know, in their 20s. They came home, and both of them sat me down and said, Dad, we heard this. And it was a whoop call. Now, one of my daughters made a really good whoop call. She said it was directed right at their camp for 2 hours the first night. And the second night, for 20 minutes until someone yelled at it to stop. And it stopped. So I was talking to my boss about this event. And he goes, well, I'm going to go up there and find out what it is. I went through the barred owl thing. You know, was a barred owl. No, Dan, it's not a barred owl. I know what a barred owl sounds like. And wasn't a coyote, you know, just went through all the animals, typical animals and stuff. And so my boss and I went up there the following weekend. And this is just, I was watching Fighting Bigfoot before, you know, he'd pound on trees and stuff. And I'm kind of going, I had it in the back of my mind, well, maybe this is a Bigfoot. I don't know. So we set up camp and we ate dinner. And then we decided to do a walk around the logging road to the periphery of where we were camping. And it's about a mile. So we walked up to the power lines first. And I just got a big old stick and whacked on the power line a couple times, nothing. So then, I didn't know about calls. I didn't do any calls whatsoever. So then about 45 minutes later, we arrived at camp. His daughter went to bed. And then Mark and I are just sitting and looking at the stars. And at 10:15, we hear 5 knocks exactly where we did our knocks. We both stand up going, there isn't anybody out here. And right when I said that, he hit his camera audio recorder, and we get two calls coming from the north, so powerful that it reverberated in your chest. And we're going, well, God, you know, of course, we're like, that was off our hook, cool. I was sold then, and nothing else happened that night that we were aware of after that. And then I wrote a report and sent to the BFRO, and so did Mark. So the BFRO became involved, and they came over the first time, and they're looking around going, yeah, right, you know, because this place is, it's got lots of activity. You got guns, fire, you know, gunfire going off all the time, ATVs zipping around everywhere. So they agreed to come out the following weekend. Following weekend, you know, I showed them what, you know, the routine, and we did all that stuff. We were hanging out at camp, 10, 15, because Cindy did whoop calls. And then, we're sitting at about 10:15. I think you got the recording there. It's a 2-minute recording of two of them vocalizing back and forth.
Let me play that real quick.
Well, they do talk back and forth. Did you notice there's kind of a singing vocal going back and forth? Did you notice that before they did the big major
yes.
calls? That's kind of an interesting thing. I've been up there long enough now, I pretty much can tell you what time of year it is just by listening to them.
That was a great recording, Larry.
That was awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that was sitting about 10 feet up in the air. That call came from about a half a mile away, but they were very powerful. What it is Cross Canyon, very acoustical. I can go there and make a call. My calls will go roughly about 6 miles.
Jesus.
It's just a really, it's really cool canyon work. They were doing this at. And they're calling, east to west.
I wanted to play the second recording.
That was the first one, you know, with Mark and I, different call. That was one Mark and I first, had our experience.
Well, let me do that. Oh, this was the first time, huh? This next one?
Yeah, yeah.
Let me play this other, the first recording then of you guys, because it sounds, I think this one's just as good.
What?
Yeah. You know, I was going to mention that, and I've mentioned this on shows before, that those recordings are very, very similar to a number of others that have been recorded up and down the Cascade Mountains since the early 70s. I know three different regions, northern Washington, southern Washington, and southern Oregon, where those sounds are almost identical to those screams. So, great job, Larry, you know, in getting those recordings.
Yeah, appreciate that. As a matter of fact, that's what got me hooked.
Everyone here at Bigfoot Hotspot Radio would like to thank Audible.com. Audible.com is the internet leading provider of audiobooks with over 150,000 different titles to choose from. To download a free audiobook of your choice, go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot.
As we return to the interview, Larry goes on to tell us about a frightening encounter he had while in his tent.
My alarm goes off. I'm watching through the ceiling because I was asleep. It's about 11:45. And it goes off again. I shut it off. And I look over my lab, and she's sitting up. Her hackles are up, and she's spinning on her seat as this thing's walking around my tent, making this whoosh type of noise. And it was doing it for quite a while, and it stopped and messed around with my table for a while, and it started walking around my tent. Well, then it came right behind, it stopped right behind me where I was laying, pushed in the tent, and grabbed my head. My head felt, for lack of a better term, about the size of a grape with its hand. And I grabbed my .45, and I was going, nope, that's not big enough. And I set it down, and it released me. You know, I was very gently manipulating my head and messing around my ear, and his fingers went over my eye socket, over the brows to my eye sockets. That's how big they were. And then it proceeded to do its thing, walking around my tent. And so I grabbed my truck keys that's got the alarm feature with the light. You know, when you hit the alarm, it also hits the cargo light. So as it's coming around my tent, I hit that, and it stops right behind my tent, the same spot where it was behind me before. So it stood there for about 30 seconds, and then it started doing its thing again. So then I guess I hit the alarm a bunch of times, and it melted off. Now, I had an audio recorder. This is on a landing out in the middle of the woods. And I had an audio recorder with me, and it picked up rock ticks at the audio recorder, so there was two of them. You could actually hear something walking around while this event was going on, too. Played around my table, took my medication out of a plastic bag that was in a box underneath the table, took four eggs, and moved my survival knife from one end of the table to the other. I think they're very inquisitive from what I could tell, and I think they know me, for lack of a better term now. I mean, pretty much tell, I usually go up there and tell, hey, Larry's here, and next thing I know, there's stuff going on during the night.
Let me ask you this, Larry. So you're in the tent, and I think I asked you this at Beachfoot. I mean, were you freaking out? I think I'd freak out if something had a tent on my head. And
well, let me put it this way. The dog, had it been a bear or a cougar, would have tore the tent apart to go get it. He chose to go in the bottom of my mummy bag and nothing flat. There I knew I was in a little bit of trouble. Not comfortable with my .45, which should have done the damage to anything. And I'm sitting there going, oh, this sucks. So that's about as much. I just held my composure. Didn't panic. And just let him do his thing.
So you just kind of accepted the fact that there was pretty much nothing you could do to defend yourself, and the situation?
Yep, and I didn't think my 45. I think if I shot him with my 45, it would have beat the tar out of me. For lack of a better term, rolled with it. Although very nervous, rolled with it. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was only one person on the planet that knew where I was, because I was pretty remote at the time. So it was like, wow, hope I make it.
How long do you think it was walking around your tent for, messing with you?
The whole encounter was about 9 minutes. I know that because that's how long the recorder recorded all the events that transpired. The audio recorder, it recorded my alarm going off, the proximity alarm, twice. That started the clock. And then at the end, when I was hitting my the truck alarm, or my, you know, my truck lock thing, that's panic mode. That was 9 minutes later.
And you didn't feel like it was still hanging around your camp after that 9 minutes?
No, I think they backed off, and they weren't hanging around me. They could have been hanging around camp for all I know, but I perceived no threat after that.
What did you do after that, Larry? After it took off?
What? Oh, after the big guy took off? Sat there and evaluated what happened to me and going, wow, I've just been touched. Dog crawled out of the bag about 10 minutes later. She settled down. I watched her. When she settled down, I settled down, and I got about 3 hours of sleep.
How big do you think its hand was?
A cat nap. Oh, I'm guessing huge. I mean, I'm just going to guess 12 inches, maybe 13, 14. It was huge. It took up my whole head from the back part, and its fingers went over my just right to my eye socket. And The rest of the hand was around my ears. Super long thumb.
Yeah, I almost wonder if the Sasquatch figured it was... It probably didn't figure or plan on it being your head. It probably thought it was trying to grab something else.
I stayed pretty still.
that kind of thing does happen. I know a friend of mine was grabbed and pulled partially out of the tent back in 1976, and it released him when it figured out it had a live body when he started struggling. But we figured it was reaching in trying to go through our food.
Oh, yeah. All the food was outside on the table, so...
So, Larry, when you go out there, you're almost always by yourself?
No. From that point on, we ended up with, like, one other person showed up. Pretty much it was two BFR folks, and then another guy, Gunnar Morrison, came along. And that night we called the crescendo night. What happened was that night we had four of them going off, similar to the calls of the second audio played, but more of a whoop type of thing. And they were moving from the east, and they covered what I would call, this is from 10 o'clock to 12:15 a.m., they moved about 8 miles in less than 2 hours, which would take Wes and I a day and a half to walk through. And
wow.
At the south where they went, then there was a crescendo, a heightened crescendo where all four of them were just excitedly vocalizing. And then in the middle, and it was done. The big alpha male kicked in. I call him Big Joe. I'll get to that in a moment. But he kicked in. It was like, okay, we got it. Give me the liver. And it was over. I mean, not a peep fence. And Gunnar sitting there, but he's a 20-year veteran, sitting there with his mouth open. And I told him before that, I said, man, I would love to hear samurai chatter. And I was giving samurai chatter. It was awesome. So he joined our group. And now we've got, eight people within the group. Got anthropologists, soon-to-be biologists. Mark and I are both metrologists. That's the science of measurement. And then, of course, I hunt. Mark's a mountain climber. Let's see what else we got. Oh, and then Shane Corson's in our group. Anyway, mostly pretty experienced people. And we decided to do this the real way. I wrote up SOPs on how to conduct yourself out there, a passing SOP, an audio SOP, a basic SOP on how to, collect evidence, a casting SOP, with the goal of being accredited for research.
So, Shane Corson's in the group?
Yes.
So pretty much anyone can get in? I'm just joking.
No, Shane actually was out. I met Shane, or Cindy met Shane out, I think it was a December night, and we just had this massive rainstorm going on. Mark and I were sleeping in tents. Gunnar was in his Jeep, and Shane was in his truck. Well, one of them came by, pulled out the stakes of my tent, threw them in the fire pit, picked up Gunner's Jeep and rocked it back and forth, and Shane heard not. We all compared notes in the morning. We're like, holy cow, they were here. And I mean, raining buckets.
Do you think they're just kind of in the area because it's a good area, or do you do something specifically to call them in?
This area here has got food year-round. I've been doing research long enough where I can identify. I can live off the land there. Now, there's deer, in this area here, they kind of walk through it, but the deer congregate about 3 miles away. There's elk that run through there. So there's rabbits all over the place. There's what you call the ground beavers, where there's tons of them over there. They're kind of like a little beaver, but they weigh about between 3 and 5 pounds. They're easy to dig up and eat. Lots of wild lettuce over there, lots of hosta. The berries are insane over there. You got huckleberries, Oregon grape, salmon berries. You got different edible lichens all over. I mean, it's just rich in food everywhere. There's no reason for them to leave. I believe that Big Joe, the big alpha male, is a year-round resident. Whether he has a female around or not, I haven't all the time year-round. I can't really say.
I'm not really 100% sure, but I know one is a year-round resident. His impressions or tracks, if you will, are 19 inches long, 8 inches at the toes, and 6 inches at the heel. And I get those all the time during the winter.
How many would you guess is around there?
4. And there's four in this general area, a kind of a little family group, if you will. And there's another family group to the west of our location, about 8 miles to the west of there.
Does the type of activity or the intensity of the activity, does it change with who you bring out there or the number of people that are out there with you?
Yeah, I think they're like smaller crowds. Like you have groups of 4, they're pretty comfortable with. They'll come right into camp. Matter of fact, like between 2 and 4, they're pretty bold. I had one that came into camp and finger painted my truck, left a nice 11.5-12 inch handprint on my truck, and the thumbnail and the thumbprint was off the hook cool. if you Google and look up a lemur handprint, that's what the handprint looked like on my truck.
I'll have to get a picture for Shannon and Will of that. I know when you showed it to me, Larry, it's kind of a fascinating picture. I mean, it's a real odd looking handprint right on his truck.
Yeah,
he
double stamped. I can only hypothesize it. He was like peeking over the truck towards my tent, and he changed positions because that's where I had the other fingerprints on the front door of my quad cab. And those things, they were, you know, my door handle's 10 inches long, and those 3 prints are like 10 inches long. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's an odd-looking print, that's for sure. It's a huge print.
Yeah, it'd be great to see those.
I got to find it. It's on my other phone. I'm talking on a new phone now, so.
Do you do anything specific to call them in, or are they pretty much, I mean, I know you had said they're kind of generally in the area, but when you show up, is there anything specific you do to kind of draw them in?
I've been experimenting, you know, with different things, and it just doesn't seem to, they're not interested in wild fish, I'll tell you that. I just kind of, once I show up, I make a little walk up a certain trail, just walk up a little ways, come back, and then I walk over the power line sometimes. Sometimes I'll just sit in the camp. They just, as soon as you start a fire, I start cooking up pork, they seem to show up. You know, but they show up pretty much on cue. I can set my clock. It's about, you know, 10, 15, 11, they start showing up. You know, they'll start sneaking in. You can hear them sneaking in. And now a new behavior is they whistle before they come in closer, that type of thing. Pretty interesting. During the winter, when things are, like, really cold and stuff, they ground thump for hours on end. I've got hours of audio between Shane and I. We got 24 hours of nothing but ground thumps. Like, say you pick up a big rock and you just drop on the ground, that thud, that type of thing. That's what they're, for whatever reason, I have no idea. I know that low frequencies travel a long way, so it could have something to do with that, some sort of form of communication. You know, I'm not really sure why they do that. Then during the spring, they do, you can tell it's spring right away because they sing. It's really weird. They do this happy whoop thing, blah, blah, blah. Sounds like come sit. I'm like, whoop, come sit. You know, and go off and do other little singing song things. It's kind of weird.
So you're getting a lot of chatter this time of year?
Yeah, it's intermittent. I mean, they're not always they're not always chattering, but there is chatter in there. And there's a song, like I said, they do this song thing I can't even explain. But we've got a 1 terabyte drive that's filling up pretty quick. And the audio process is such as I analyze it, then it goes to like David Ellis, and then it goes, we're creating files for Ron Moorhead and the crypto linguist that he's got on board. And then Paul Graves is also listening to some of this stuff, so it gets vetted.
Yeah, it sounds like you have a great spot there, Larry.
Yeah, I'm kind of addicted. I keep on buying new toys. I'm not a technician by trade. I'm a trawlist, so I bring the technology in. So.
Do you hear a different type of vocalization during the day than you do at night when you're out there?
Well, I haven't heard any vocalizations per se during the day. I will say that they they knock quite a bit during the day. The interesting thing is like, say there's Shane and I are up the trail, we'll wait for Gunner to show up, coming in from where he's coming from. They knock. And then 5 minutes later, here comes Gunner. That's amazing. Or if one of our guys is ahead, we'll hear a knock. So they're around pretty close to where we camp all the time. For whatever reason, the vocalizations that I've heard only happens, you know, after dark. I haven't heard anything during the day yet. Probably just because of the general activity around there, with the, you know, guns, you know, they're not afraid of guns. And there's shooting going on all day long, even at night. Pretty acclimated to shooting and human activities around the area. Doesn't seem to faze. I guess they're masters of hiding because nobody seems to know they're there.
Woody and I had our encounter. There's not far from there, there's a place where people go to shoot. And so I don't think gunfire like that really shakes them up too much.
No, I don't think so either. Some of these guys are walking around with, I know some guys are caught about 3 miles from where I was at. They were shooting into a rock pit with a 50 cal.
Have you tried to get them on camera, or have you taken a thermal out to record them?
I bring a thermal with me all the time. I have not been successful yet. Just haven't had the luck where I caught one out in the open. The time that they were whistling at us, they weren't more than 20 yards from our camp. And when I swung around to hit it with the therm, I didn't see anything because it was in the brush. And, you know, I guess it ducked down or whatever, but we couldn't catch anything on therm because it's so thick. Close range is pretty thick stuff. You got the salal, you know, the salal and all that other stuff, and salmon berries and Oregon grape, you know. A lot of cover for them to hide in.
Yeah, it's pretty hard for those thermals to break that brush.
Yeah, and that was our problem. We couldn't break it. But we try. I mean, one of these days, I mean, I've got all this stuff. I get a lot of good audio. I mean, now I'm running, just myself, I'm running 5 audio recorders. And then if anybody else goes up, there's usually 3 more. So, you know, you're talking, for me, 72 hours of audio at a time.
Yeah,
you
that's
just
a
pick
lot.
Up a lot of stuff. And I'm still evaluating last weekend's. That was 72 hours just for myself. We had a lot of good stuff on it.
I appreciate you coming on, man.
Yeah, and as I get, you know, I'll promise you this. As soon as I get audio that's been vetted and stuff, that's okay for releases. None of our research is in the public eye, per se. Just what's public knowledge. Like those audio recordings are on the BFRO site. None of our stuff is out there. There's basically everything that we're doing is getting checked by independent researchers and stuff, or independent sources. Like audio is getting, you know, that goes to like audio engineers and all sorts of things like that. And then wildlife biologists, blah blah blah. If we get stuff that's like good to release, I might pass a few nuggets on your way.
Yeah, please do, man. Please do.
Yeah.
The ones you sent me are pretty awesome.
Oh yeah.
Thank you for coming on.
Yeah. No problem.
Yeah, thanks very much, Larry.
My pleasure.
I want to thank Larry for coming on the show and putting up with us, me specifically. This next segment is called News. A lot of our fans out there have been asking us our opinions on different things that are going on in the Bigfoot world. And so we decided to bring Shannon LeGros on to give us an update on what's going on in the Bigfoot world. We record these through Google+. And I'll be posting the video on our Facebook fan page under Bigfoot Hotspot Radio. So if you get a chance, check it out. Hope you enjoy. The boys love Shannon.
I saw that.
So we'll let her do all the talking. Well, you and I will just...
Oh, you open with that. Don't make me blush on camera. Stop it now.
People say they can't hear Will. They say I look pale like a cancer patient. they love Shannon, so I figured we just let Shannon do the talking tonight. We'll just kind of sit back.
Except my first story is Will is definitely a part of this one. It is Stacy Brown's finding of the, and this is his tag, okay, he did come out right off the bat and say, non-human primate arm, But I will add to that, that in some of the newer videos on YouTube, they are throwing in the two words skunk ape in there. So I'm like, no. And Will knows, because I would post a story to keep everybody up to date on the page. And Will's in there going, monkey, 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 monkey. Right?
That's right.
So, yeah. So everybody was getting a little excited. And I know, and I'm not making fun of Stacy Brown. I think it's awesome, right, that he's out there. He's boots on the ground. He's gung-ho about it. Excellent. Awesome. But let's just everybody take a breath. Maybe get some information that it's actually something anomalous before we go, oh, my God, look what I found.
Wasn't it Florida he found this?
Correct.
And our buddy Dave Mobley, who's an expert hunter, he came out. He said, sent me an email, and he said, "We have over 1,000 feral monkeys, rhesus macaques,
yeah,
in that area. I mean, and what is it, about 18 inches long? I mean, come on, it's a monkey arm."
And at one point, he was saying, one of his posts just read, "Oh man, this thing is weird." But you're thinking, well, it's in an advanced state of decay, so it's anything looks weird when it's decaying, and there's barely any flesh, and there's no hair.
Right.
So everything looks strange then.
I think everyone in the Bigfoot community is kind of jumping the gun on this whole thing. Part of it is Stacy Brown's fault. I mean, I met Stacy, he's a nice guy, but I think I would have had it examined first, instead of just blasting it everywhere before it's even been examined.
And, you know, the interesting thing, it's once again, you have to look at the motivation for why would somebody blast something out there before finding out any detailed information about it?
Yeah.
I mean, what's the whole point of it? It's to get attention.
Right. And that's unfortunate. And I mentioned this. I was just happy that no mainstream media picked up on that, because it would have made everybody look pretty bad.
Well, I'm sure they know it's a monkey arm too, so.
Yeah. you get this, the ones that want these fluff stories, and they'll run with it, and they'll kind of go along with, or maybe add their own to it, you know, and go, oh, Sasquatch arm found in Florida. You're like, no. Next on the agenda is Les Stroud is doing 6 more Survivor Man Bigfoot. I don't know about you guys, but I admire Les Stroud. I really like him.
Les is a great guy. Is he still with the Muppet Maker?
I surely hope not. And the fact that you brought that up, that was my biggest question. That was my big question with it. Is he going back out with Todd Standing?
I'll give people a lot of credit when they're doing work, but the hoaxers, in my opinion, should be highlighted and tarred and feathered in public.
I love it.
The Muppet Maker.
So I just hope that Les, even if he goes out with, you know, 6 different researchers in 6 different areas or whatever he chooses to do, great, but maybe go in a different direction with who you want to team up with, please.
Yeah, I hope it's not 6 more episodes with Todd Standing.
Lord.
Hope not.
I don't personally have anything against him, but I just hope it would be more interesting to...
Unless he has fresh Muppet videos.
Now, on those videos, I haven't really looked at them that much because I don't like stressing myself out over garbage. You know? One of the questions that was posed to me in an email yesterday was, what was the before and after video? Those 2 pictures, right? There wasn't really video. Is that the case?
There was video, but and then I had gotten on a thread about it, because I actually did post. It was just a funny picture. I'm not really one for making fun of people. It was kind of more of an in general, like, this is what's going on in the community right now, because somebody had posted a couple of puppets and they had the trees in front of the face right in the same spot, and I was dying laughing. So I posted that, and somebody goes, I go, you know, there's not even a blink in the video. And somebody goes, no, if you go to this video, there is kind of a blink, but it's like this, it's
mechanical. It's not,
it's
not
so
living.
Mechanical.
Oh, my chair is conspiring against me here.
Uh-oh. So.
No, I think what happened is he had posted that first video of the one just sitting there. And I know some of the criticism he got was, well, why doesn't it blink? And then all of a sudden he comes out with his next one, and then it blinks, you know? And so it was like,
yeah.
What was the lead up? I mean, you know, like with the Patterson film, you see it, it's walking and then it goes away. You know, there's sort of a beginning and an end to it.
Right.
With standing stuff, all we see is this, these two faces. There's not really anything, any movement. The head doesn't move. There's no lead up to it. It doesn't back away.
You know, yeah, what I mean? And they're both just the bust. You know, it's
right.
So they're both in the same position, and he has the carefully placed logs and trees and such. So.
And like with the Patterson film too, you know, when they went back, there were tracks. You know, they did all kinds of stuff with the site after the creature left. With, you know, this hoax stuff, there isn't any of that. Uh-oh, we lost Shannon again. Damn it, we got to come up with stuff ourselves.
Seems like I didn't even leave. There we go.
There you go.
I'm getting faster at what I need to push to get back online. Okay.
Yeah, thank God. God knows people don't watch these videos for me and Will.
That's right.
Sure they do. Of course they do. Everybody loves you guys. You can...
No, you're right, though, Will. There is no lead up. There's no what happened next. It's just kind of a glamour shot. You know, it's just kind of a...
Yeah, there's no peripheral evidence. There isn't anything. I mean, and I think that's the hallmark of a hoax. You know, it's the telltale signs that say, hey, you know, there's something wrong with this because they don't have A, B, C, D, and E. They just, there's this. And that's, to me, that screams baloney.
Yeah, I think Todd Standing falls into that category of people who had legitimate sightings. And right. I've been seeing a lot of it lately, but they'll have legitimate sightings or they'll have legitimate experiences. And then it's almost like they start fabricating. I can't figure out why they start fabricating, but it seems like everything then becomes Bigfoot. Everything, you know, either they kind of go off the deep end and they have Bigfoot on the brain, or they fall into the second category, kind of like Todd Standing, where it's obvious he's hoaxing. It's obviously it's hoaxing, it's faking, it's fabricating.
What I think happens on a lot of these cases or a lot of these people that come into this subject, they have an encounter. It just sort of excites them to the point where there's that adrenaline rush and they want to become famous. They want to do all this stuff. But, and what you and I both know this after the first sighting, you know, you're lucky if you get another one after that, but it can be many, many years. For me, it was, I think, 14 years to the next one. And that was 26 years ago. But a lot of these people can't say, well, okay, I'll go out and do some research. I'll do whatever. They have to have that next rush. It's almost like taking drugs. You know, they want to go to the next high. So then they can't get it. So then they start fabricating stuff. And especially if they get a television show or something like that, then they're really hooked.
Well, the pressure sure is on at that point. I mean, he's got Meldrum and now he's got Les Stroud. Les Stroud has been a star in his own right. He produces his own shows and directs his own shows, and he's got ratings to the roof, and now your train is hooked to that, so you better produce something.
Right, that's the gravy train for him, so
yeah,
that's his claim to fame and fortune, you know, so if he doesn't do something, he's out on his ear.
You know, and the unfortunate thing is, he like you said, he probably genuinely really does want to experience it again or see something again.
And some of these people that get propelled into those positions and they don't really have any foundation in the subject, so they're kind of thrown out there to the wolves, so to speak, and then they don't know what to do because they have no experience being a Sasquatch hunter.
You know, sometimes I think a TV show would be better just to show the real side of it instead of going into abandoned houses and having the production crew bang on the siding for you, and you go out and unload buckshot on half the county. I think that, you know.
Now, what
show the real side of it?
What show could we be referring to?
There? I don't remember the title of that one. So it's escaping me right now.
Some of these people that come into this stuff, like our buddy Rick Dyer, those people that come along and do this junk make the whole subject look horrible. That's why nobody in professional circles will touch this with a 10-foot pole.
Well, I wonder what they did with the Hank mobile, you know? Didn't that get like repoed or where is that now?
I think that's what it was, yeah. I'm sure he's probably using Hank as a pillow now or something.
It would be comfortable. I mean, it's well, just sure, a stuffed dog, guys.
Exactly.
Comfy. Oh my goodness, a pillow. That was incredible.
maybe that's one of those body pillow things. I don't want to go there.
Oh, but yeah. That would definitely be a full body pillow. Hank was a big doll. He was large. They needed a whole trailer for him.
Maybe Rick gets lonely, you know. I don't want to know about it, but you know.
Yeah. That might be the nicest word we use for him, right?
That's right.
We're going to channel Renee another time, but for now we'll call him Lonely.
Right. Yeah. Lonely.
I like that, Will. Well, it's like, okay, zip mom's word after right. that? Lonely.
That's okay. Right, Lonely.
That's a mess.
we're just having a good time right now.
So. This is one of those evenings, you know.
It is. It really is. Look what I've started. Okay. Moving along. We'll leave Tricky Ricky alone for right now.
People could just imagine what it would be like to sit around the campfire with all of us with beer in our hands.
Yeah, right? This is without the beer. So imagine. Well, what a nice segue into my next item on the list.
There we are,
campfire, thank you for the assist.
Gave you a nice lead in.
You absolutely did, because it's about the it's about the Yakima Bigfoot Roundup. I spoke to Tommy Amarone a couple days ago. Shout out to Tom, he's a super nice guy. It was really great to talk to him on the phone. He's got that get together he's doing. And
Will, are you gonna go to that?
Yeah, Will, are you going? Thank you for putting me on the spot. I was going to do it, but now you get to be the backup.
Can we just get a yes hopefully. Or no?
Hopefully.
That means no. He's not going.
That means no? Oh, no. Yeah.
But no, it doesn't.
Okay, it's a definite maybe.
Means that's he's got right. other plans.
It's a definite maybe.
I'll tell you what, Shannon, let's place bets on it. I'll put $40 down right now that Will's not going. What do you want? You want to match that or you want to?
I mean, yeah, I'll definitely at least match that. Unfortunately, you might, you know, have some insider information here, so I don't know if I can trust you on this bet. So
let's bump it up to 80. Let's see.
Now I know you have inside information. No, we do hope that Will is going for sure.
I hope he doesn't. I got $80 riding on it.
Well, see, now I shouldn't take the bet because maybe Will wants to make you some money and help you out. So, no, I'm not going to think about it.
Are you going to go to it, Shannon? We just lost her again. Man, what a mess. This Google Plus is kind of a mess. No, if you can get time off.
Plus doing it?
Yeah, I think so. If you can get time off, you should go, man. Mm-hmm. I'll probably take my mics the way I did last time, like at the Beachfoot, set up interviews. Yeah. It's like the life of the party just left.
I know. What's going on with that?
I think we lost her.
I think so. She's not so fast at coming back on. Oh, there she comes.
All right, sorry, that was not fast that time.
Talk about something else. Here she's back.
I'm back. Stop talking about that fake bet.
Now that you're back, Shannon, I'd like to actually increase it. Let's go $500. I'm going to say Will's not.
Whoa, I know what you guys are talking about while I was gone. Dang internet connection. Can't let that happen again.
What kicked you off, actually?
Right? You know, I know, right? An error occurred on Google Hangouts just now. Right. How strange. I see what's going on here. Okay. Next action item.
I was going to say, you're going right, Shannon.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Shannon and I are in purple up there. You should come, Will.
I'm going to try to.
Definite maybe. That's good. Uh-oh. He's shaking his head, Will. $500. I can't believe it.
Get your checkbook ready.
Yakima Bigfoot Roundup is worth much more than $500. I'm telling
you. What are the dates on that? Is it 10th, 11th?
And the 12th.
12th, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Next month. Yep. There's a video that I posted on the page. It consisted of some Canadian gentlemen, and they were standing up on a bluff, looking down over a glacier, and it is not a kid-friendly video. Okay, they are dropping F-bombs, which adds to the authenticity of, you know, what they're seeing, because they're a little shocked and surprised. It appears to be a very large figure of some sort, considering the distance that it's, you know, from them, from their vantage point. And it is absolutely booking it down this glacier. And Will, I know that we had chatted and you said that you saw it and you found it to be interesting. It's not one of those in your face videos or the quintessential walking away video. You can't really see too much except that it does seem to be something large and it is traversing the terrain quite well.
Yeah. And it's kind of an unusual location for, bear are normally hibernating, you know, in those conditions. So, and I don't remember what time of year it was supposed to be shot, but it's kind of out of place for what's there and what it's doing.
It's just a little different than, you know, the norm that we see. You know, it's not a stump squatch that's not moving kind of a thing. So that was nice to see.
Or not a blob squatch.
Yeah, no more blob squatches, guys.
Those things are worthless. I mean, really, if the picture is not fairly clear, and a lot of these are guesswork. You know, you see a picture of trees, and then somebody, the next picture, they've drawn lines where they think something is.
Yeah.
And it's always amazing to me in these blob squatch pictures that the creature happens to be the same colors as the surrounding foliage. Now, tell me why the Sasquatch is various shades of green.
It's odd, isn't it?
Yeah, come on, folks. It's just trees and stuff, you know.
No, it's didn't you hear? It's their new auto camo button they press for themselves. And now it's yellow circles instead of red circles, which somehow adds validity because they're yellow circles now, guys. So there's that.
Oh, well. Yeah. That reminds me of the interdimensional guys years ago who we called him the button pusher. He says, well, they move in and out of dimensions because in another dimension they're food for dinosaurs. So when they're about to be caught and eaten, they push a button in their chest and they go into our dimension. And I thought, I wonder what button he pushes to come back into our dimension.
Yeah, where's your button, man?
Where's your button?
Because I don't want to hear anymore. Yeah. So yellow circles, yay.
It's gone past even blob squatches. Now the new thing is they'll just show a picture of the forest and then they'll tell you there's 30 Sasquatches there.
Yeah.
They're a bunch of damn nuts. I mean, yeah, really.
There's this one guy on there who's actually, and I won't mention his name, but he's actually a really nice guy outside of Bigfoot. But the moment you start talking about Bigfoot, and I kind of seen him decline mentally since the last time I talked to him, but you know, now he's saying that they have between 30 and 100 Sasquatches on his property, and he just posts these pictures, and it's kind of turning into like a religious.
Is that the one that says that they have the he spotted a human female half naked hanging out with the Bigfoot on his property?
I think that is him, yeah.
And then the comments were like, you don't want to call the police if you have a half-naked woman running around your property? You know, it's just, I mean, it's insanity.
Maybe he's lonely too.
Yeah, lonely. Well, that's our new code word, period.
Lonely.
That's fantastic, Will. That's code word.
You can tell it's attention too, because he kind of posts like, don't take offense to this, Shannon.
I won't, believe me.
He kind of posts like a woman on Facebook. He's like, I'm done with everyone. I'm going to leave for a while. And
I'm tired
of everyone's comments.
I think I've seen that.
And then if you look at the timestamp, an hour and a half later, he's like, I'm back, everyone. I'm blah, 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 blah.
Well, you know, the clue ought to be when you talk like a nut and put things out publicly, that's, you're going to get the reactions that you, based on what you put out there.
Yeah.
So if you talk like a kook, people are going to respond to you like a kook.
He's a mess.
Yeah, it's gotten bad. It's gotten real bad.
And for all the people on YouTube world, I don't have cancer. I'm not. I know I'm pale. I'm actually not that pale. I get the red background.
Did you see the comments about the, remember I was teasing you about the satanic background?
Yeah.
People were actually saying that on YouTube.
Yeah.
Uh-oh, we lost her again.
Yeah, we lost her. There goes our ratings.
That's right. Right in the toilet.
We'll tie it, everyone. Yeah, the biggest criticism we got was, I don't remember, I think people were saying that, like I said, I'm not as pale as I look on camera, but everyone thinks that I had cancer. And the other complaint is they can't hear Will, and then the other comment we'll have is like, well, then Shannon's hot.
It's, like, it's the same person posting over and over again.
Right, exactly. Yeah, can we get anybody else's opinion? Yeah, exactly. The last thing I wanted to mention, I don't know if everybody knows, but we do have two different Facebook pages you can go to. There's the radio station page that has the Sasquatch Chronicles logo, you know, as the quote-unquote profile picture. The other one is also called Bigfoot Hotspot Radio. It is a public group, and it will just have, like, whatever the last four people that posted on the page, that will be the profile picture, is four different people. Will gets on there quite often in comments and posts, and I get on there quite a bit. Maybe we'll start reeling Wes in there to get him on there too. But yeah, everybody come join us on that page as well.
I'm not actually a part of that group.
Wes is well, in the hot tub.
Right.
He's in the hot tub with beer.
And use it in the hot tub. We'll add you to the group.
Yeah, I found that group, I don't know, was it about a month and a half ago, Shannon? I think you were in there.
Yeah.
What is this group? Whoever created this group, I was like, this is cool. I went down through all the lists of comments. I was like, wow, this group's pretty cool. And I realized I had admin privileges in the group. And I was like, wow, this is nice.
Sweet. Yeah, it's a busy little page, huh, Will? We get to going in there.
Beat somebody up, you know?
Yeah, you want to sometimes, don't you?
I know, I do. I really have to refrain sometimes.
I know, I can only imagine. So yeah, that's my all-encompassing, exciting news. Yeah. Right. And out.